Shalom, brothers and sisters. Shalom. I saw this video by GMS Mark Them, and it's about, looks like this through the spirit of Yahweh Shem El Shai. Lord's not don't want to leave out GOCC, while all these other camps have been, put for the for to the brought to the forefront, with all their damnable heresies and all their, twisting of the doctrine and not coming on the one accord, so. Through the spirit, I saw this video right here, and the brother said, the big brother elder said that also. He said that through the spirit, he found this GLCC video of this hell doctrine, this false hell doctrine. So because of this, I just thought, it'd be great just to repost his video, plus also repost a video that I did on the hell doctrine as well. Just to get that cleared up, to all the brothers and sisters out there that's coming in the truth. Understanding that they are the Hebrew Israelites, as the so-called Negro, Hispanics, and Native American Indians. So, we could all get this 100% understanding of the truth, of the scriptures, and seek the Lord's face and get the understanding and be on one accord with Yahweh Shem El Shai and the understanding. So, with that, I'm just gonna play the repost of this understanding hell video. Okay? Hopefully, it's edifying.
Brothers and sisters, Shalom, Shalom. Hey, first and foremost, I want to turn to the east and give all honors and praises to Yahweh, Bahashem, Yahweh Shai, Bahashem, Rekakadash. I want to give double honor to the elders and apostles, Great Millstone, for bringing out the 100% truth, teaching us everything we know. Shalom to the 144 hopeful elect who's pushing his word in all truth and sincerity, and one third of Israel who believe in the word and follow the land wherever he goes. Hey, Shalom, everybody. Yeah, I wanted to bring this epistle out, and I wanted to do it right. I wanted to start it right here in this location to get to this matter of heaven and hell. Through the power of Yahweh Shem El Shai, through the Spirit, and with the teachings of elders and apostles of Great Millstone and other brothers on down, we understand now that hell, the doctrine of hell from the Christian church, is a false doctrine. But the true meaning of heaven and hell is only a condition. Hell being a condition of the mind, a state, and we're about to bring that out in the scriptures. And also hell meaning here in the grave. All right, so we're going to bring that out right now. It's the book of 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 6.
It says, "The Lord killeth and make it alive." That's right, because the Lord is all powerful. He's the one that decides who lives and who dies. Remember, he said there's not a sparrow that falls out of the sky that he didn't sanction it, man. That's some serious business. That's why we feel the way we feel about Yahweh Shem El Shai, when we come to the understanding. That's why it says, fear the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, man. So, hey, we ain't talking about no false God and no false idol, so-called name Jesus Christ either. We're talking about the one true living God, the God of Israel. The ones that's written about in these scriptures here. All right? So it says, this is 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 6, "The Lord killeth and maketh alive. He bringeth down to the grave. He bringeth up." Because also there's a such thing as reincarnation. And we know about the resurrection of the Messiah as well. But the Lord is the one that decides who lives and dies. And he's got the power to bring you up from the dead, from the grave, if he even wants to. All right? But it says, "The Lord liveth and maketh alive. He bringeth down to the grave and bringeth up." Right? "The Lord maketh poor and maketh rich. He bringeth low and lifteth up." So that also goes into the heaven and hell. So if you're down poor on the ground, you're living off the, begging from day to day for your daily bread. You don't have a roof over your head. You're pushing a cart around. Your ass is in hell, man. But on the other hand, if living on Fifth Avenue somewhere, if you're one of them silver spoon babies, don't have to worry about nothing. You got people making your coffee for you, bringing it to you in your bed before you even get out of the bed. You're in heaven. It says, "The Lord maketh poor and maketh rich. He bringeth low and lifteth up. He raises up the poor out of the dust and lifteth up the beggar from the dunghill. He set them among princes and make them inherit the throne of glory, for the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and he hath set the world upon them." So the Lord's saying right there, hey, I'm the one that created the heaven and the earth. And then he goes and gives us a little nugget of future prophecy right here. He raises up the poor out of the dust. Who's the poor? That's the so-called Negro, Hispanics, and Native American Indians. Uh-huh, you got that right. Ain't we the poor ones on the earth? Only the ones that despise on the earth right now? But at this particular time, the Lord has woken us up to the understanding that we are the lost 12 tribes of Israel. We are the poor. And we're in our captivity right now. This is our curse. This is our punishment for standing in front of Moses, accepting the law, statutes, and commandments from Yahweh, Hashem, Yahweh Shai, from the Most High, God Almighty. Understanding the curse and the blessings, and then went on to not do the law, statutes, and commandments as we promised the Lord we would do. So therefore, we are now under the curses. And that which brings us in this low state that we're in now. We're in hell right now. Brothers and sisters getting shot in the back, shot in their own homes now, for goodness sakes. Can't do nothing about it. There's no justice, there's no peace, right? That's hell. It says, let's read verse 8 again. So this is 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 8. He rises up the poor out of the dust. So he's waking us up. He's rising us up out of the dust, man. So because before, we had the spirit of Yahweh Hashem Yahshua upon us. The Holy Spirit to understand what's going on, who we are as a people. We were in the dust. We were in the grave. We were in the dirt. We didn't know who we were. And that takes us to the valley of dry bones. Huh? We're going to get to that later. And he lifted up the beggar from the dunghill. He set them among princes and made them inherit the throne of glory. He's going to make us inherit the throne of glory, man. That's the 144. We're coming out here for the 144, hopefully elect, and the one-third of Israel. Who's going to believe these words and repent and continue on, man, in the Lord before he comes back? You see, he's already on the earth right now, judging his place. So we're coming out here bringing out the 100% truth to the brothers and to the sisters that will understand these words. Because he says the rest of Israel are blinded. They're going to continue in this Christianity or these other doctrines out here, but they will not understand the 100% truth of the Bible. That we are the lost 12 tribes of Israel. The so-called Negro, Hispanics, and Native American Indians. Let's read it one more time, then we're going to go to the next location. This is 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 8. He raises up the poor out of the dust and lifted up the beggar from the dunghill. He set them among princes and he make them inherit the throne of glory. Right? So we're going to inherit the kingdom of heaven, man. And that's what we're waiting on right now. The Lord to come and get us out of this hell hole that we're in now. It says, for the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and he has set the world upon them. All right. That's it, brothers and sisters, for now. I'll see you at the next location. Shalom.
Everything you're about to see and hear are for educational purposes only. No monetary gain.
Time alone, oh, time we. Okay, Shalom, brothers and sisters. Shalom, Israel. So we're back here in the second location. We're just going to get to the bottom of heaven and hell, life and earth. Now look, I'm sorry, life and death. So like, let me slow it down a little bit. Because everything you're about to hear and see does require faith. Okay? Plain and simple. Mustard seed size, if you have any. Okay, so yeah, because you know, being reborn, and this is the baptism through the word, you know, being refreshed, getting a better understanding and the 100% truth understanding, you know, of the scriptures. That's what being reborn means. Forget all the stuff that you were taught about hell, life and death, you know, dying, then oh, they go to hell because they were bad, things like that. So, just going to quickly get into it. But first, I wanted to bring hold on, that one battery there. We're going to bring out this scripture here in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4. It says, "For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty, through Yahweh Hashem and Hashai, to the pulling down of strongholds." So, you know, we are using this spiritual, we're in this spiritual battle right here, just bringing out the 100% truth. And the word of the Lord is quick and powerful. Though these are the weapons. Read again. This is 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4. "For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty, through Yahweh Hashem and Hashai, through the Spirit of the Lord, to the pulling down of strongholds." So this is one of the strongholds of life and death, heaven and hell. Alright? We're going to get the definition real quick. Now, listen, this, as I was putting this together, man, through the Spirit, I found that, it looks blown out. As I was putting this together through the Spirit, I found that this lesson is gonna have to segue not only to cover heaven and hell, but also our life right now, where we are right now. You know, with the race wars kicking off with prophecy. Basically, let's say just a little bit, just a, because you can't speak of one without the other, okay? And excuse me for 1 second, I gotta adjust this lighting, man, because I don't like it. All right, Slacky. Okay, thank you. The water, should I say? And let's get into this. So first, we're gonna bring out the definition, just quickly, of heaven and hell, okay? This is hell, and this is in the Growler International Dictionary. The abode of the dead, okay? The underworld, where departed souls were delivered to dwell, okay? Specifically in the Hebrew scriptures, Sheol, and in Greco-Roman tradition. So, they're saying that it's the underworld where souls were believed to dwell. Believe is the word that pops out. Believe, because hey, that could go either way. Is it true or is it not true? Alright? So we're going to come with the scriptures to specify what happens to the soul after it dies. Okay? Then they go on to say, they throw a little bit in the Hebrew scriptures, it says. But the scriptures of the Bible were written in original Hebrew. They actually tell you exactly what happens with the Spirit. We're going to bring this out through the power of Yahweh Hashem El Shai, through the Spirit, and also from the teachers of the Great Millstone, elders and apostles, man, you know, and the other brothers on down. And in Greco-Roman tradition, now that is also another word that pops out, tradition, because the Lord said don't follow the traditions of man, and that's definitely a tradition to keep this mumbo-jumbo going up let's read it again. The abode of the dead, the underworld where departed souls were believed to dwell. That is the tradition, that they believe that they dwell in the underworld, okay? This is number two. The abode of condemned souls and devils, the place or state of torture and punishment for the wicked after death, presided over by Satan. Now, right there, that is the actual that is the actual definition, Salaki, y'all, definition of the traditional hell. All right, I'm gonna read that again. The abode of condemned souls and devils. So that's what that's what traditionally hell is supposed to mean, right? The place or state of torture and punishment for the wicked after death, presided over by Satan. Okay, and it says the infernal powers of evil and darkness. So now number four is the definition that we want. All right, because this is what hell really is: a place or state of great iniquity, misery, discord, or destruction. Okay, and that's why in the intro there you saw the pictures of the ghetto. That who's living there? The so-called Negro, Hispanics, and Native American Indians, right? Yeah, a place of state or state of great iniquity, misery, discord, or destruction. All right, torment, anguish, something that causes agony. And you better believe that our lives cause us agony, grief. You see, that's why they're rioting in the streets actually right now, because of all this. And one of the pictures that you saw, one of the last pictures that you saw, was actually of the Native American Indians. He had on a hood jacket, a jacket, so he looked almost like he was in the heart of the ghetto somewhere, you know, over that grave site. You saw the so-called false god and false idol Jesus Christ right there is one of the statues they put down there because they're going off worshiping a false god and a false idol, you know, standing over the grave when ain't nobody there, you know, things like that. So that was actually on a Native American Indians reservation. Okay, so before we move on to get the definition of heaven, I want to read this hellhole definition. Hellhole, a hellish place, especially one of extreme wretchedness and squalor. Okay? A place characterized as hellish by reason of riotousness. Okay? Or lewdness, supposedly prevailing there. Okay? And what is that? That's like the ghetto. That's like lewdness would be like one of those clubs. Like in Atlanta, they had what? Shit, I can't even remember. I think they had the one called the Blue Flame, at least. You know, just lewdness. And righteousness is going on all over the place now. Brothers killing brothers in the hood constantly, you know. So that is hell. You know, in some places, people are scared to, you know, have trouble going home from school because they're getting, back in the day, pushed to go and join a gang or not, you know. So just that's hell on earth, man. Now this is heaven. It says, often plural, the sky or universe is seen from the earth firmament. Okay, so there's heavens, there's four heavens, and the Heavenly Father lives in, you know, way beyond all of those. The abode of God, the angels, and the soul of those who are granted salvation. They almost got it. Okay. That's where the Lord lives. He lives in another dimension somewhere, up in the heavens. The abode of God, Yahweh Shem El Shai, the angels, and the souls of those who are granted salvation. Okay, we're going to come back to that, souls of those who are granted salvation. Because in the end, the Lord, he's going to bring back down the new heaven, which is New Jerusalem. Okay? All right? So heaven's going to be on earth. All right? Because what? Let's just get down to the bottom of it. Brothers and sisters, and all that are listening. I'm talking about the so-called Negro, Hispanics, and Native American Indians. We're coming out here bringing these words, this truth out here for the 144, hopefully, elect of Israel, and the one-third of Israel who's going to hear these words, repent, and be healed to the one true living God. And stop listening to the traditions of men, you know, that's leading you astray. So that's what this is all for. But the Lord said, preach this word to all the nations, because the children of Israel are also scattered throughout all the nations. So they may look like the heathen, even though their spirit, you know, they're going to hear this word and be like, what? Yeah, I can get down with that. I hear that. I believe that. And that's what it takes, man. Okay. The Abdob of God, the angels and the souls of those who are granted salvation. Because heaven is going to be new heaven. It's going to be new Jerusalem. The Lord's going to beam us up out of this wicked place, this hell on earth, before the nuclear missiles come down and destroy America the Great, Babylon the Great. Okay? That is going to become the lake of fire that everybody thinks this hell is. Okay? So you know, you will be saved out of the lake of fire. But everyone that's wicked, and all of the wicked, which is Esau, Edom, will be burned up in that lake of fire, a Babylon the Great, a.k.a. America. And that's simple. That's actually it. That's heaven. That's hell. That's hell on earth. All right? We're in hell on earth right now. But that is the lake of fire that everybody's talking about. Period, point blank. Okay? But we can close the book. We can shut it down now. Really? I mean, if you believe that, because that's what it is. We're going to bring it out in the scriptures. Is that all I wanted in here? Let's continue. The divine providence. May heaven help you. Often plural. The Ephim. Hold on. The celestial powers of gods. The heavens favor the young ruler. A supreme. Okay, here. This is the definition we wanted for heaven right now at this particular time. Number 5a. Supreme happiness. A state of bliss. A thing or place which is wonderful or enchantingly perfect, a sheer delight. Okay, so you see the contrast. Heaven is a thing, a supreme happiness, a state of bliss, a thing or place which is wonderful or enchanting, perfect. Okay, and this is hell, a place, a state of iniquity. That's sin upon sin upon sin, misery, discord, or destruction. Okay, so you see the contrast, and thus the pictures of that I give you of the ghetto, somebody living in squalor, you know, just every turn is tough, and then heaven. Yeah, I gave you pictures of Fifth Avenue and all the beautiful, you know, the scenery, everything. You know, everything is nice and clean, nice and tidy, organized. No trash all over the place. There's got service all over the place. You know what I'm saying? I didn't even go as far as to talk about the great mansions and the villas. Also, you know, the great estates, the great the jet setters, the people that have got acres and acres of land where there's nobody else around but their little one house on this 40 acres of land. You know, things like that. That is heaven. All right, now let's get into some more scriptures, man. We got that. Now look, let's get into now this is gonna bring us to Ecclesiastics, because when I first came into the truth and the understanding of the truth, you know, to the best of my abilities, you know, at that time, I first got on the street. I think I was out there preaching maybe like my second or third time, and this guy come up. I'd never forget him, and I seen him around, you know, afterwards, and he asked me. Said his friend just died. What happened to his friend? Is his friend in hell or is his friend in heaven? And I said, you know, at the time I really didn't know. I didn't have the understanding at that time. So I told him, you know, I would have to get back to him with it. But I tried to give him the information. I said, hey, go to my big brothers and the elders and apostles of Great Millstone, you know, and we can find it together, you know. And he just walked off. I think he was half drunk at the time. And, you know, it was good, because that is a chastising, and that's how we learn, and that's how we grow, you know, by having questions asked of us and having to go find the answers, man. So it was beautiful, and I went and got those answers, man, and I found them, you know, from my big brothers of Great Millstone, you know, through the Holy Spirit, I was able to understand. So this is the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 12, verse 7. And it simply says, and this is where your faith comes in at, because it's simple. Then shall the dust return to the earth as it was, Okay, so what the Lord created us from the dust of the ground, remember? And the spirit shall return unto Yahweh Hashem El Shai, who gave it. Bam. Simple as that. So the spirit returns to the Lord. This fleshly body here just goes back down and dissolves back into the dirt. But your spirit goes back to heaven, man. Bam. Goes back to the Heavenly Father. Now, my big brothers can tear this thing up back and forth, you know. So my understanding right now is right here. But we're going to continue on. We're going to stay in Ecclesiastes. We're going to jump back over to verse 3. Verse 16. And this continues on. And moreover, I saw under the sun the place of judgment, that wickedness was there, and the place of righteousness, that iniquity was there. This is another understanding where it just takes a little bit of faith to understand that, hey, reincarnation is real, all right? And that's in the scriptures as well. And we're going to get to that in just a second. So, moreover, I saw under the sun, right here on earth, the place of judgment. So, therefore, the traditions of men will tell you that you're going to go to heaven and burn forever, and that's your judgment for being wicked. But this is the place of judgment, says the scriptures. And moreover, I saw under the sun the place of judgment. Right here. This is the place of judgment. That's why some people are born, you know, with one leg. You know, or something happened to them. They die early on, you know. That's their place. This is their place of judgment. I'm going to reset this now. So, this is their place of judgment here. And we're about to get that right now. Let's go ahead and get it in the book of John, chapter 9, verse 1. And this is good information because this gives us, you know, it says, hey, man, you better get yourself together. And we're talking to you so-called Negro, Hispanics, and Native American Indians, okay? Because the Messiah came down to die for our sins, right? But if you don't take the opportunity to repent to the one true living God, then your sins will not be covered. Therefore, thus, you would get judged for your iniquities. All right? And that's it. Simple and plain. So this is the book of John, chapter 9, verse 1. And as Yahweh Shai passed by, he saw a man which was blind from his birth. So this man was blind at his birth. Okay? And his disciples asked him, saying, Master, who did sin? Who did sin? Because that's his judgment, to be blind. Alright? Who did sin? This man or his parents? That he was born blind. Alright? You see the understanding that you need here? Just a grain of mustard seed. And you know, if the Lord has blessed you with the understanding here, because it's plain as day. Who did sin, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Okay, bam. Yahweh Shai answered, neither hath this man sinned nor his parents, but the works of Yahweh Hashem El Shai should be made manifest in him. I must work the works of him that sent me. While it is day, the night cometh when no man can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. So that's a twofold scripture. It's partly letting us know that, hey, that man was born blind so the Lord could heal him. All right? But it also shows you that judgment is under the sun when you're reincarnated back into the flesh. Because when you die, your spirit goes to the Lord. Whatever you did here on earth, you get judged for it when you come back down, and you have to live it out your judgment, whatever your punishment might be. Okay? Simple as that. Then the other part is for us, the 144 hopeful elect of Israel, and the one-third who's going to, you know, who believes his word. Because it says, I must work the works of him that sent me while it is day. The night cometh when no man can work. So that's for us, to telling us to push this word out. This 100% truth of the scriptures. Don't worry about what nobody say. Who gives a fuck if they laugh at us or whatever. Fuck it. Because we got to do the work now while it's still day. Because there's going to come a time in the time of Jacob's trouble when they're going to close down the internet and all this stuff, and you won't be able to work anymore. So get all your works done now while it is day. Okay, because no man can work at night. Okay, and as long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. So that's why the Lord said, let your light shine. Let this truth be known, you know, while we're in the world. And that's it, okay? So, I just wanted to put all that out there. Because those things about this false doctrine, about this heaven and hell, about this so-called devil in red spandex and pitchfork and stuff to torment the souls is put forth by who? It says the Greco-Roman Empire, right? Which is Esau, Edom. Because once again, they're trying to hide who they are. Because they are actually the devil that the Bible speaks of. And that's the Caucasian race. And you can see it is evident how they run around killing people constantly and doing all kind of wickedness on the earth. You know, and they get away with it. Why? Because, oddly, number two, is that this is their heaven, while it is our hell, because this is all about Esau and Jacob, okay? Jacob being the so-called Negro, Hispanics, and Native American Indians, the children of God, and Esau, Edom, is the son of perdition, the son of the devil, which is the Caucasian race. All right, so we got to get this and get that understanding in the book of Genesis, actually, real quick, just a quick one. And that's Genesis 25, I believe, 25. We're going to go to 23. So this is Genesis chapter 25, verse 23. And the Lord said unto him, two nations are in thy womb. Two nations, two manner of people, okay, shall be separated from thy bowels. And the one people shall be stronger than the other people. And the elder shall serve the younger. So one people should be stronger than the other people. That is the Negro, Hispanics, and Native American Indians. That's Jacob. Okay? And the elder shall serve the younger. So it was meant that the elder, the one that come out first, are going to serve us. So the Caucasian race are really supposed to be serving us right now, Jacob. And when her days to be delivered were fulfilled, behold, there were twins in her womb. And the first came out red all over. Okay, so he came out red because his blood shows through his skin. Simple as that. Okay? That's why they want to cover up the redness and say that there's this devil, you know, and he's red. Oddly, you know, but hey, it's not them, okay? But it is them. The first came out red all over like a hairy garment, and they call his name Esau. And that's thus we get the term Esau, Edom, the Edomites. That's them. That's their lineage. And after that came his brother out, and his hand took hold of Esau's heel, and his name was called Jacob. And Isaac was 80 years old when she bare them. So, and that's it, brothers. That's the story of Esau, Edom. They're red, but they're trying to cover up the fact that they are red, the red devils. The red horse, also written up in the book of Revelations. That they're the old serpent. They're the dragon. And it's all coming clear. All give all thanks and praises to Yahweh Hashem Yahshai for giving us this understanding. We're gonna go to okay, we're gonna have to brighten this up. Hold on. There we go. It's because of the back. Ooh, I should close. So like it, brother, let me close these curtains here. Okay. Now we're going to move on to 1 John chapter 2, verse 18. And listen, this is the spirit right here, man, because I had no idea that this was going to segue in the condemnation of Esau, Edom. I didn't, but that's they're going to get a little poked up and stabbed. Because why? When you're talking about heaven and hell, you begin to talk about the people, right? And of course, there's one people living in hell and one people living in heaven. And that's how they're coming out. They're being exposed. So this is the book. Yeah, because they always talk about, you know, the American dream. And, hey, you can get it if you work hard enough for it. But, hey, the bottom line is that the scriptures do not lie. And all these things are coming, you know, coming to pass. All these prophecies have been coming to pass, and things have been revealed. And just simply, their kingdom is coming to a close. They're about to get kicked out of the heaven because they are the devil, as the Bible speaks of, being kicked out of heaven. I'm going to get into all that right now. So this is the book of 1 John chapter 2, 18, and this is segueing from them being read and this devil doctrine here. Little children, it is the last time, as you have heard, that Antichrist shall come. Even now are there many Antichrists, whereby we know that it is the last time. And Antichrist is someone who contradicts the words of the Bible, who are full of sin, who's sinners, who's wicked. Okay? That's why we know it's the last time, because there's many Antichrists. They went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been with us, they would no doubt have continued with us, but they went out that they might be made manifest that they were not all of us. And this is most of our brothers and sisters also who are cleaving on to these false doctrines and religions as well. They're antichrist because they're going against the scriptures. They don't care about the word of the Lord. And that brings me to Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 10. I think that's right. Yeah. You know, simply put, because anybody that's against the scriptures is against Yahweh Shema Shai. Simply put, you don't want to listen. You don't want to. You don't want to do what the Lord has said. You got to learn this death by pain. You got to go through the fire, and that is hell. Well, the lake of fire, should I say? Okay. So this is Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 10. To whom shall I speak and give warning? That they may hear, right? Because this is only for the 144, hopefully elect, and 1/3 of Israel, who will hear and believe and repent. Because they're going to be flabbergasted, man. They're going to be like, what? And then they're going to be so happy that to get the truth. Nobody want to live in a lie, right? So it says, behold, their ear is uncircumcised, and they cannot hearken. Behold, the word of the Lord is unto them a reproach, that they have no delight in it. Because some people are the Antichrist. Some of the Native American Indians, the Hispanics, and the Negro. They just be like, no, that's not true. You know, because they will wholeheartedly believe. They would rather believe a lie than the truth. Now let's go to the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I was going to read the whole thing, y'all. But this is mostly for... you know, the people with a little bit more understanding. But this video is out for everybody, man, to bring in the hopeful 144, hopefully elect, and 1/3 of Israel. So I don't want to talk too much, and I don't want it to be super long. So we're going to just jump to the point. Let's start at verse 9. So this is 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 9. Wherefore we labor that, whether present or absent, we may be accepted of him. So we're laboring. This is for us, the one that's bringing out this doctrine, and the other 1/3 that believe in the word. So we're doing what we can to please the Lord and to turn away as much as possible from this wicked kingdom. You know, the idea, the thinking of it, and to think more spiritually, and have more faith of the Lord and lean on the Lord even more, especially in this time of Jacob's trouble coming up, because we're going to need him, because these devils are about to come with all hell. they're about to come down with great wrath on us, man. This is verse 10. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Yahweh Shema Shai, that everyone may receive the thing done in his body according to that he have done, whether it be good or bad, right? Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men, but we are made manifest unto God, and I trust also are made manifest in your conscience. So we know, you better do what's right to the Lord, man, because we understand the terror of the Lord, and we're trying to make sure we're doing it for ourselves as well, because we're trying to please the Lord as much as possible, because we're afraid of the Lord, and we're telling you to be afraid of the Lord, okay, because, yeah, man, this is the book of Luke chapter 12, verse 4, and I say unto you, my friends, be not afraid of them that kill the body, and after that have no more that they can do. So hey, don't worry about all this other stuff, Okay, because these fleshly bodies, as we just read, spirit goes back to what? Yahweh Ba'ashim Yahushua. Okay, you're going to stand in front of him and be judged. So, hey, you don't want to be done nothing wrong. You hear me? When you stand in front of the Almighty, the creator of the universe. Okay? It says, but I will forewarn you. And this is in the red letter. This is the Messiah speaking. Whom ye shall fear. He's telling you who you should fear. Fear him which after the he have killed, have power to cast into hell. Yea, I say unto you, fear him. Okay? Fear him. And what's he saying? The one that had power to cast into hell, right? He's talking about the hellfire of the nuclear missiles. Also the hell that you can put upon you here on earth, living down here on earth. Because one of the brothers brought that out. He said, hey man, the Lord is so powerful. He can have you come back. And the other brothers brought out other epistles where they seen brothers, people having the whole body just burned. But they didn't die. So they have to live with this fucked up, burnt up body, man. Okay? Just all kind of stuff. There's a dude with his mouth like wide open. It's all deformed. He had to live like that. You got people that's born all like this. Oh, somebody got to take care of their whole life and they're just in there. Oh, and just agony. And people, they won't kill them. But just instead to die. They have to live like that, man. The whole life, man. That's why this scripture is very, very powerful, man. It says, but I will forewarn you whom ye shall fear. Fear him which after he have killed have power to cast into hell. Yea, I say unto you, fear him. So you better fear the Lord. That's why the scripture, what does it say? Three times in the scriptures. Let's get it. In Job. Hold on, y'all. There it is. Job 28, verse 28. And unto man he said, behold, the fear of the Lord, that is wisdom. And to depart from evil is understanding, man. So the fear of the Lord is wisdom. When you fear the Lord, you're going to depart from evil. Because you understand that if you don't, your ass is grass and the Lord is the lawnmower. You know what I'm talking about? Because Oh, look, we're in Job and we got to go to Job chapter 9. Verse 24, anyway, to continue on, this is the book of Job, chapter 9, verse 24. The earth is given into the hand of the wicked. Okay? So that, right there, lets you know a lot. The earth is given into the hand of the wicked. And so the wicked is the one controlling this place. So that brings to mind that scripture, when the righteous... Well, let's get it. Let's get it. This is the book of Proverbs, chapter 29, verse 2. Proverbs, chapter 29, verse 2. When the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice. Okay? Because there's a time on earth where the children of God actually ruled the earth. And everybody was pretty much happy. You know, the days of King Solomon. Everybody's okay. Everybody kept in their corner. You know, they did the thing. When the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice. But when the wicked bears rule, the people mourn. And that's what's going on now. In the Apocrypha, it says when Alexander the Great, the Greek, took rulership and started taking conquering lands and the earth, great wickedness and great evils were multiplied on the earth. So there you go right there. But when the wicked bear rule, the people mourn. And also in the clip, I started that clip off, and you saw, I think that was in some other countries as well, where poverty was all over the place. And that's because those countries have been corrupt by the devil. And they're putting wicked people in authority over those people, and they don't give a shit about those people. There's no reason why people should be living like that. And best believe... when the Lord brings down the kingdom of heaven, New Jerusalem, and he's here ruling the earth. Ain't nobody gonna be acting like that, man. No, no. Everybody's gonna be paying tribute to the one true living God, and that's when life begins. The good stuff. Okay, because right now, what's the scripture say? When the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice. But when the wicked bear rule, the people mourn. And who's in control? This is verse Job chapter 9, verse 24. The earth is given into the hand of the wicked. These people, the Caucasian race, Esau, Edom, the fucking wicked. Motherfuckers run around here with all manner of wickedness, dude. Going contrary to the word of the Lord. Greedy as fuck. You know, running up in everybody's country telling them, hey, where are you now? You're less than. You're not supposed to be here anymore. You know what I'm saying? Just gone, man. Let's continue on. We're going to go back to the book of Genesis chapter 27, verse 39. Okay, this goes back to Esau, okay? And let's go to 38. So this is 27, verse 38. And Esau said unto his father, hast thou but one blessing, my father? Bless me, even me also, O my father. And Esau lifted up his voice and wept. Now, if, in case you don't understand, right before this, Isaac has given Jacob the blessing. Should I read it? No, just for good. I'm not going to read it. But Isaac has given Esau. I got to read it, man. No. We're not going to read it. It could take up too much time. But anyway, the only blessing that Esau got is here. This is the book of Genesis chapter 27, verse 38 again. And Esau said unto his father, hast thou but one blessing, my father? Bless me, even me also, my father. And Esau lifted up his voice and wept. And Isaac his father answered and said unto him, behold, thy dwelling shall be the fatness of the earth and the dew of heaven from above. Okay? So that's the point anyway. That's why they want to go back, brothers and sisters. So Esau's blessing is the fatness of the earth. That's why you can find them anywhere on the planet living it up, living it good. You know, he's living in some of the best places. He's not in squalor. You know what I'm saying? That's Esau, Edom, the Caucasian race. And it goes on to say, and by thy sword shalt thou live, and shalt serve thy brother, and it shall come to pass when thou shall have dominion that thou shalt break his yoke from off thy neck. So that was in the dark ages when Esau, Edom, the Lord gave Esau, Edom the power to overcome Jacob once again. And that kicked off the Renaissance. Okay? When he came back into power. And this is where he is now. He's got the fatness of the earth and he's living by his sword, the gun. You know what I'm saying? The weapons of war. He's bullying people, just, you know, doing everything he wants. And that's his blessing. But his blessing is, and the point of the matter, behold, thy dwelling place shall be the fatness of the earth and the dew of heaven from above. The fatness of the earth. That's why you see the video, the little pictures of Fifth Avenue, Saks, all that stuff. That's in New York. He's all in Beverly Hills, everywhere. Colorado, just doing it up, man. Just doing the big things. Jet setters, man. All right? Now let's go to the book of Psalms, chapter 73. Psalm 73, verse 5. Well, let's just read number 1 to 5. Truly, Yahweh Shema Shai is good to Israel, even to such as are of a clean heart. So, these scriptures are all about the children of Israel, which is the Native American Indians, the Hispanics, and the Negro, okay? But I was envious at the foolish when I saw the prosperity of who? The wicked, right? So we saw the prosperity of Esau, Edom, the wicked. I mean, everywhere you go, you see them. They're riding in convertibles. They're doing good stuff. They're in heaven. You understand? All right? And it says, you know, before we came into the truth, we might have been a little envious of them. And everybody's chasing that same dream, the so-called American dream, trying to get what Esau, Edom has. But this is their blessing, right? Because there's a balance to everything. The Lord has given everybody a little taste of the pie. So when it's time for judgment, hey, they can't say we didn't never have that. But the last state, the children of Israel are going to be in heaven. But it's going to be an everlasting heaven. It's going to go on forever and ever. It says, but as for me, my feet were almost gone. My steps had well nigh slipped. For I was envious at the foolish when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. For there are no bands in their death, but their strength is firm. Right? They are not in trouble as other men, neither are they plagued like other men. And that's the point. That's the meat of what we're bringing out here. They are not in trouble as other men, neither are their plagued like other men. Why? They don't have the curses on them like the children of Israel have the curses. You know what I'm saying? They're not in trouble like other men. Why? Because the earth is given to the hand of the wicked. They run the place. They run the world. They set the rules. That's why it's okay. They can do things and not really get in trouble for it. You know what I'm saying? They can go into people's house and shoot them up and say, oh, I was afraid. That's why I killed them. But you're in their home. But, you know, hey. They can put their necks on the back of a man in front of everybody and get third-degree murder. It wasn't intentional. I didn't really try to do it. I mean, even though the man said it couldn't breathe, hey, what? I eventually let him up. You know? Hey. Let's continue on. So, let's go back. Let's get back to this more of life and death thing. And heaven and hell. Okay? Let's go to the book of John. And again, this is going out to the 144 hopeful elect and the one-third of Israel, okay? And this is the book of John, chapter 8, verse 32. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Now, I remember in the cemetery, I was reading about 2 Samuel. About, we're going to get that. Let's go get it. I'm sorry, it was 1 Samuel. Let's go get it and read it real quick. Just to bring us back to the mindset so we can understand a little bit more clear. So you should know the truth and the truth shall set you free. Okay. Okay, so this is 1 Samuel chapter 2. Verse 6, and we're going to bat around, we're going to come back to this and bat it around with a few more scriptures to get a better understanding of 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 6. The Lord killeth and maketh alive. He bringeth down to the grave and it bringeth up, right? The Lord maketh poor and he maketh rich. He bringeth low and lifteth up, right? He raiseth up the poor out of the dust and lifteth up the beggar from the dunghill to set them among princes and to make them inherit the throne of glory for the pillars of the earth are the Lord's. For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and he had set the world upon them. Right? So the Lord said, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. Now, okay, y'all, something I slipped up and I messed up on the time, so I know it should be okay. We're just gonna go back to get the understanding. We're gonna go back to 1 Samuel chapter 2 verse 6, as well as because we read John chapter 8 verse 32, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Right? we're going to go back to 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 6 to get a better understanding of it. We're going to go here and then bat around a few more scriptures. So you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. So this is 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 6. The Lord killeth and maketh alive. He bringeth down to the grave and bringeth up. Okay? The Lord maketh poor and he maketh rich. He bringeth low and lifteth up. So he had us at a state of richness, then he made us poor. Right? And he's going to bring us back up to be kings on the earth again and rulers again. He rises up the poor out of the dust. This is talking about us. This is when he blew the breath of life into us and gave us this understanding. And lifted up the beggar from the dunghill to set them among princes. Right? So this is the beginning of that. Because then that goes in that scripture. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. So first, we're free in the mind. Even though we're still living in these ghettos and these places of hell. You know what I'm saying? That's basically it. Because we're still living in hell. Our life is still here, hell. We're still under the curses. But in our minds, we're free because we understand the truth. We understand now what's going on. What happened. We understand that we're the Israelites now. We've come back to our heritage now. That's big. Because before, we just thought we were some niggas, some black folks, some Hispanics, and some Native American Indians, man. So the Lord's granting us mercy. And that's why it brings us to, I'm going to put a little bookmark here on 1 Samuel. And we're going to go to Ezekiel chapter 37, okay, y'all? Okay. And Ezekiel 37 is a wonderful, wonderful, it's just wonderful, man. It's beautiful. Let's read it quickly. We're just going to read Ezekiel 37, 1 through 14. The hand of the Lord was upon me and carried me out in the spirit of the Lord and set me down in the midst of the valley, which was full of bones. Okay? And remember, we was in the grave. But it's that we was in a grave because we were in a dead state. We didn't know who we were. And caused me to pass by them round about, and behold, there were very many in the open valley, and lo, they were very dry. And they're laying around, all around these other nations. And some of these other nations, some of these people know that we're the children of Israel, but they won't tell us, man. This is verse 3. And he said unto me, Son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, O Lord God, thou knowest. Yehovah Shema Shai, you know it. You know if they can live or not. Again he said unto me, prophesy unto these bones, and say unto them, O ye dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. And that's what we're doing. We're coming out here to the 144 hopefully elect and the one-third of Israel, the so-called Negro, Hispanic, and Native American Indians, brothers and sisters. We're prophesying to you, letting you know who you are, that you are the lost 12 tribes of Israel. And it's time to repent and come back to the one true living God, okay, before all hell breaks loose on this earth. The gates of mercy are still open. That's why we're still able to make these videos and still go out on the highways and hedges. Warning you. Trying to tell you to come back. Okay? Thus said the Lord God, Yahweh Hashem Yahshai, unto these bones, behold, I will cause breath to enter into you and ye shall live. Okay? That's big. And that's what we're talking about. That's the understanding, the truth and understanding of the scriptures, man. We shall live. Because what? These scriptures are the path to salvation, okay? And I will lay shinus upon you and will bring up flesh upon you and cover you with skin and put breath in you, and ye shall live and ye shall know that I am Yahweh Hashem El Shai. What else is, what? You see that? He said, I will lay shinus upon you. I will put, you know, strength, and I will put strength on you. And will bring up flesh upon you. I will give you your identity back. Let you know that you are the lost 12 tribes of Israel. You are the Israelites. And cover you with skin. And put breath into you. Put this understanding, this knowledge into you. And ye shall live. And ye shall know that I am the Lord. Yahweh Hashem El Shai. We're going to know the Lord's name again. Okay? We're going to know that, hey, we've been messing around with these false gods. These false idols of these other nations. We've been deceived. Okay? And when I beheld, lo, the shinus and the flesh came up upon them, and skin covered them above, but there was no breath in them. So You know, that's, and that goes into the prophecy of they stood on their feet and great fear fell upon those that saw them. That's in the book of Revelations. Then said he unto me, prophesy unto the wind, prophesy, son of man, and say to thus to the wind, thus said the Lord, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied that he commanded me, and breath came unto them, and they lived, and stood upon their feet, an exceeding great army. Right? Then he said unto me, son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. Behold, they say, our bones are dried and our hope is lost. We are cut off from our parts. Therefore, prophesy and say unto them, thus said Yahweh Shem Shai, behold, O my people. See, the Lord's people are still the house of Israel. You know, don't listen to the traditions of men that say, oh, all people can get a part of this salvation, because it's not true. It's a lie. It's another tradition of men. I will open your graves and cause you to come up out of your graves and bring you into the land of Israel. Okay? So there we go again. Coming out of the grave, out of that hellish condition. And it's going to put us back up. And it goes back to, let's just keep on going. We're going to come back around to that. And ye shall, and he's going to bring us back. So it's future prophecy that he's going to bring us back to the land of Israel. Not now. I mean, you know what I'm saying? Because that lets you know that those people over there, they've stolen our heritage. You know, they're not the children of Israel. Because they so-called know that they were these, they said that they were these people. They never lost their heritage, but we've woken up to who we are. Okay? We were gone. We thought we were somebody else. And ye shall know that I am Yahweh Shem Shai when I have opened your graves, O my people, and brought you up out of your graves. And shall put my spirit in you, and ye shall live, and I shall place you in your land. Then shall ye know that I, the Lord, have spoken it and performed it, say Yahweh Shem Shai. So that's beautiful, right? Yes, it is. Now, let's go to the book of, where are we going? We're going to go to the book of Luke, chapter 16, verse 19, to double down on this heaven and hell real quick. That was just future prophecy right there. Hope that, hey, the Lord is coming back to save us, O children of Israel. That's it, man. No matter what happens, we're going to be okay, man. So Luke 16, verse 19. Now this battery is about to die. And this epistle is going a little bit too long. I thought it was going to be really like 20 minutes, man. So lucky, brothers and sisters. This is the book of Luke, chapter 16, verse 19. There was a certain rich man, now this is a parable, which was clothed in purple and fine linen, and fared some sumptuously every day. Okay? And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate full of sores. So there was a rich man, and like we were saying, there's some people out here, Esau, Edom, who don't have to worry about nothing. They live so great every day. They live wonderfully every day. Some of them have people bring them coffee while they're still in their bed, like I said before. They live in the best places. They have the fatness of the earth. You know what I'm saying? They don't even have to worry about getting in trouble with the law, because who? The earth is given to the hand of the wicked. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at the gate full of sores, and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. Now, what they always say? What those rich people always say? Something about some trickle-down effect. You ever heard that? The trickle-down effect? That, hey, you give the big rich companies, you know, a lot of tax exempts and everything, and the wealth is just going to trickle down to the rest of the people. Right? There you go, right there. And then, it says, moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. The dogs are speaking of the other nations. All praise to Yahweh Shem Shai for getting us this understanding through the elders and apostles' great millstone. The dogs are the other nations, man, coming around. That's why they're in our neighborhoods. The Chinese store, the Arab store. So whatever trickle-down money, you know, we get from the elites of Esau, Edom, they come and scoop that money right back up. So we're not putting that money in our neighborhoods or circling our back around in our neighborhoods. We're giving it back to another nation, and they take it back and do whatever they want to with it. And we have to go get more from Esau, Edom. Okay? And desired to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. And it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. And the rich man also died and was buried. So the beggar died, which is us. Okay, and keep in mind this is just a parable. And in hell he lifted up his eyes, being in torments, and seeth Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. So the rich man went to hell, and he lifted up his eyes, being in torments, and seeing Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger into water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. So it's a parable, keep in mind. So he went to hell, and he's able to talk to Abraham and Lazarus, you know, as the beggar was talking to him at his gate, asking him for crumbs and things on his table, you know, waiting on the crumbs and stuff on his table. So he's in hell now. He's in torment now, just like we're in hell and torment now, you know, having to worry about getting shot in the back from the cops, you know, just by our racial profiling, you know, if we can make the rent and pay the light bill and put food on the table. And that's what the he's asking for water to represent that, you know, hey, you know, just give us a little extra helping hand here. I'm in hell and I'm being tormented. It's not easy. He said, have mercy on me. Just like the people are saying right now, no mercy, no justice, no peace. You know, hey, what? Can't y'all do something? Can we live a little bit better than this? Why does it have to be this bad, man? Shit, man. We've been working all, but we still can't get nowhere, right? But Abraham said, son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receiveth the good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things, but now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. So, bam, the tables are flipped, because the Lord is perfect balance. And like I said earlier, the Lord made sure that all the other nations, they got a piece of the pie. They got their rulership. They got their comfort, you know. While Israel was at the bottom, getting beat up, trampled on, talked badly about, a byword and proverb, you know, the curses up on us. Bam, you know. And beside all this, between us and you, there is a great gulf fixed, so that they which would pass from hence to you cannot, neither can they pass to us that would come from thence. So there's a great gulf fit between them. So there's a, just like now, you know, there's a few black people that seem like they're rich, but they're under the spell and the hand of the rulers of this wicked kingdom. So if they say anything that's out of pocket, they're cast down back into hell. Look at Bill Cosby. Look at R. Kelly, you know. So there's a great gulf fix. You can't really be like them at this particular time. Okay? Because this is their kingdom. You can't rule in their same, you know. It just appears to be that way, but it's not really. Okay? So it's a great cold fix. Then he said, I pray thee therefore, Father, that thou wouldest send him to my father's house, for I have five brethren, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment. Abraham said unto him, they have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them. And he said, nay, Father Abraham, but it is, if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent. And he said it to him, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. That's right, because right now, and that goes back into judgment too, because we're telling y'all to repent right now, you so-called Negroes, Hispanics, and Native American Indians. Repent now. You don't, because it says Israel looks for a sign, but the Lord has already risen from the dead. That is the sign. You just have to have the faith and understanding to see it, man. That's it. Like I told you before, man, my nose, when I start doing these epistles, my nose always just start itching, man. Okay. So that brings us back to Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 7 as well. Oh, let's read this 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 6 again. The Lord killeth and maketh alive. He bringeth down to the grave and bringeth up. The Lord maketh rich. I'm sorry, the Lord maketh poor and he maketh rich. He bringeth low and lifteth up again. He raises up the poor out of the dust and lifted up the beggar from the dunghill to set them among princes and to make them inherit the throne of glory. And that speaks about what we just read, the parable of Lazarus, don't it? Doesn't it sound like that? And then we're going to go to Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 7 real quick. We only got a few more to go, y'all. This is the book of Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 7. And the Lord thy God will put all these curses upon thine enemies and on them that hate thee, which persecute thee. And thou shalt return and obey the voice of the Lord and do all the commandments which I command thee this day. And that is prophecy being fulfilled right now, because the Lord is actually slowly, the Lord make it poor and make it rich. He bring it low and lift it up. That is him taking the curses off of the children of Israel, the one who has returned to him. You know, he's uplifting our minds. He's got us returning and not committing all these iniquities, sin upon sin upon sin. We are actually following the law, such commandments to the best of our abilities now. We got the name of the Lord. We do whatever we can to please the Lord. So therefore, he has... And the Lord thy God will put all these curses upon thine enemies and on them that hate thee and persecute thee. That's why you see Esau's kingdom's going down right now, my man. It's going down. Slowly but surely, it is coming down to a halt. We're going to go to the book of Psalms, chapter 9, verse 17. Uh-oh, I went too far. Here we go. Book of Psalms, chapter 9, verse 17. It says, the wicked shall be turned into hell, and all the nations that forgot Yahweh Shema Shai. For the needy shall not always be forgotten, and expectations of the poor shall not perish forever. Arise, O Lord, let not man prevail. Let the heathen be judged in thy sight. Put them in fear, O Lord, that the nations may know themselves to be but men. Selah. That's a powerful scripture right there, because it speaks of what we just spoke about. The wicked shall be turned into hell, and all the nations that forgot Yahweh Shema Shai, because they want to promote untruth, the Antichrist stuff. They want to go against scriptures. They want to pretend like there is no God, or they're making these false gods and false idols and worship them. They won't let us know that we're the lost 12 tribes of Israel, you know. So the Lord say, the wicked shall be turned into hell. So now, y'all going to suffer like the children of Israel did. Just like it said, the curse is going to be turned upon your enemies and all those that hate ye. Okay? I got to reset the camera, brothers and sisters. Where is that? Okay. Now... Brothers and sisters, we're about to get to the toward the end of this epistle. And we're going to go to Isaiah chapter 14, verse 5. It says, Yahweh Shemal Shai has broken the staff of the wicked and the scepter of the rulers. He who smote the people in wrath with a continual stroke, he that ruled the nations in anger is persecuted and none hindereth. Okay? The whole earth is at rest and it's quiet. They break forth into singing. So this is future prophecy, because the Lord is about to come down and take down Esau, Edom. And as in Isaiah, in 1 Samuel, you know, the Lord kill and make it alive. He bring it down to the grave and bring it up. The Lord make it poor and make it rich. He bring it low and lift it up. He raises up the poor out of the dust and lifted up the beggar from the dunghill to set them among princes and to make them inherit the throne of glory. For pillars of the earth are of the pillars, for the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and he set up the world upon them. Okay, because the Lord is all powerful. He does whatever he wants. And then it goes back to Psalms chapter 9, verse 17. The wicked shall be turned into hell, and all the nations that forgot Yahweh Shemal Shai. And this is saying the same thing. Okay, so we're just going to read from Isaiah 14, 5 down to 9, I believe. The Lord had broken the staff of the wicked and the scepter of the rulers. He who smote the people in wrath with the continual stroke. Yeah, because remember, the earth is given to the hand of the wicked, and when the wicked bears rule, the people mourn. He that rules the nations in anger is persecuted, and none hindereth. Nobody stopped that devil from running around bullying all the other nations, stealing their resources, telling them who they are, renaming everybody's nationality, you know, putting us in these chains. The children of Israel, the apples of the Lord's eye, you know, lying upon us, stealing our heritage and our land, all kind of things like that, man. This dude, it's time for him to go down. But once again, this is this epistle is about heaven and hell, right? So they're in heaven, we're in hell, all right? Also about life and death. The whole earth is at rest and is quiet. They break forth into singing. So once again, this is future prophecy. Yeah, the fir trees rejoice at thee, and the cedars of Lebanon, saying, since thou art laid down, no fellow has come up against us. Yeah, because these devils also promote the Christmas tree, you know, tearing them all down and dragging them into your house. You know, this this false doctrine, again, you know, that goes against the scriptures. Because Jeremiah chapter 10 speaks about, don't follow the ways of the heathen. Don't do what they do by cutting down those Christmas trees and dragging them in your house. This is verse 9 in the point. Hail from beneath is moved up, moved for thee to meet thee at thy coming. It stirred up the dead for thee, even all the chief ones of the earth. It hath raised up from their thrones all the kings of the nations. And they shall speak and say unto thee, art thou also become weak as we? Art thou become like unto us? So, that's, once again, Esau, Edom, the rulers of this wicked world being cast down from heaven into hell, just like everybody else now. You know what I'm saying? Being brought down low to the squalor that you made all these other nations subject their people under, and how you treated the children of Israel as well. This has become, like, you know, yeah, condemning the nation of Edom and letting them know that the Lord is about to come down and pass judgment on you, Babylon the Great, a.k.a. America. It says, thy pomp is brought down low, brought down to the grave, and the noise of the vials and the worm is spread under thee, and the worms cover thee. That is all everything. That's why all the jobs are drying up here. Society is just coming down to a screeching halt. And all this is done by Yahweh Hashem HaShai. How art thou fallen from heaven? There we go again. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? And those are the light bearers, the Illuminati, the wicked elites of this society. How are they falling from heaven? Because that's what's gonna happen. That's about to happen to y'all. You're up in your heavenly place. Everything is so nice here. You're up on your penthouse with your garden on top of the rooftop up there, with the swimming pool up there. You're in heaven, man. While everybody else is down, scrounging around day to day, hoping to pay the rent, man. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weakest the nation? For thou hast said in thy heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars. And that goes into that definition of heaven being the firmament above the earth, okay? So that's when Esau, Edom, the Caucasian race, went talking about they want to put a satellite up there in the International Space Station, even now with SpaceX and all that. I will exalt my throne above the stars of Yahweh Hashem HaShai. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. That's right, they're sitting upon us, the congregation. We are God's chosen people. They're sitting on us with their knee in our neck, as you have seen around the world. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. And that's their ultimate goal, to be like Yahweh Hashem HaShai. That's why they're coming out warning with the RFID chip. Do not take this mark of the beast. That's the RFID chip. So they want to chip you and know who, where you are, what you're doing, who you are. And, okay. It says, yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the size of the pit. Okay. So now you're about to get brought down to hell. And a lot of y'all are going to go into the lake of fire. Okay. Which is Babylon the Great, aka Miracula, when the nuclear missiles from all these other nations are shot over here because they're sick of your crap. And this is all put forth by Yahweh Hashem Yahashai, of course. And then, yet thou shalt be brought down to hell to the sides of the pit. They that see thee shall narrowly look upon thee and consider thee, saying, is this the man that made the earth to tremble and did shake the nations, did shake the kingdoms? Why? And this the man. Who? Esau, Edom. They're going to what? Narrowly look upon thee. Why? Because you're going to be working in the kingdom of heaven as slaves. You're going to be just like Lazarus and the rich man. You're not going to be up in heaven on your lofty perch anymore. You're going to be down. Because hell is condition of the mind. You understand? Alright, let's move on. That should be enough on that. And hopefully y'all get the understanding of that. We're just going to go from there. We're going to go to Revelation chapter 19, verse 20 real quick. And the beast was taken, and with him the false prophets that wrought miracles before him, with which he deceived them that had received the mark of the beast and them that worshipped his image. These both were cast alive into the lake of fire burning with brimstone. And that is also the warning of anybody taking their RFID chip. You so-called Negro, Hispanics, and Native American Indians, do not join them. That's why I brought up the passage. Don't be afraid of the one that can kill the body. So you tell this man, this devil, no, man, we can't do that. We can't go against the Lord, no matter what. Because what the scriptures say, be afraid of the one that can kill the body and then make you regret having to take that mark of the beast, the RFID chip. Alright? When he can bring up your soul, put it back in another body and torment you, hurt you continually. You know, for as long as he wants. So that's why the scriptures say, be afraid. Don't be afraid of the one that can kill only the body. Be afraid of the one that can kill the body and the spirit if he wants to. Okay? You be afraid of the one true living God, the God of Israel, Yahweh Hashem Yahashai. Alright? So this is it. And the beast was taken with him. The false prophets, okay, and that's all these people that's coming around with Christianity, with these other doctrines, that's not 100% truth of the Bible. There are many antichrists that wrought miracles before him, with which he deceived them that have received the mark of the beast and them that worship his image. So anybody that's joined hand in hand with these devils and with their philosophies, with their with anything that has to do with this wicked world, because the whole earth is given to the hand of the wicked. Everything they promote is definitely anti-scripture. That's why the Lord said, come out of her, my people. Don't be thinking of them. You got to know who your enemies are. I mean, this knowledge, this understanding, being on one accord with Yahweh Hashem Yahshai is the way. That's life. That's eternal life. Knowing, you know, what's going on, who these people are, what they're doing. You know, knowing that, hey, I'm not supposed to be doing that. I better do this because the Lord wants me to go this way. He don't want me to do that stuff. Come out of her. Come out of that thinking. Don't do it. All right? These were, okay, who worship the image. And that goes for all these people that's rioting in the streets talking about they want justice. But this is the justice right here. This is the Lord coming back to save you, children of Israel, you so-called Negro, Hispanics, and Native American Indians. All right? To save us. Hopefully we're part of that number, the 144, hopefully like the one-third of Israel, who's going to believe these words and repent and be healed. Okay? It says, these both were cast alive into the lake of fire burning with brimstone. And the remnant were slain with the sword of him that sat upon the horse, which swore proceeded out of his mouth, and all the fowls were filled with their flesh. Okay? So that's just talking about the end of days, man. After all this is said and done, after they've implemented the mark of the beast, after we've gone through Jacob's trouble, the last plague are the 200 million missiles that's going to be shot from all these other nations onto Babylon the Great, aka America, which will make that the lake of fire. Okay? And that is the hell that these devils been trying to get everybody to believe that it's under the earth in a different realm or something, and that's where you would be going to get tormented. But that's not the case. You will be burned up in the lake of fire with the wicked, with Esau, Edom, and anybody else that didn't want to repent to the one true living God. Okay? We're gonna back that up with the book of Isaiah, chapter 28, verse 9. This is the book of Isaiah, chapter 28, verse 9. Whom shall he teach knowledge, and whom shall he make to understand doctrine? Them that are weaned from the milk and drawn from the breast. For precept must be upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, line upon line, here a little and there a little. And that's why we bounce around the scriptures, you know, to put them all together. For with stammering lips and another tongue will he speak to his people. That's right. So we're coming out here proclaiming these words to the hopeful 144 elect of Israel, the 144,000 and one third of Israel who's going to believe these words. And it's a Negro, Hispanics, and Native American Indians. And all others with the seed line scattered among all the other nations of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, okay? To whom he said, this is the rest wherein ye may cause the weary to rest, and this is the refreshing, yet they would not hear. So these words are the rest. That's why the scripture says, ye shall know the truth, and truth shall set you free. But y'all didn't want to hear it. The two-thirds don't want to hear this. They don't want to hear this truth. They don't want to come back and repent. But the word of the Lord was unto them, precept upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little and there a little, that they might go and fall backwards and be broken and snared and taken. So because you heard this word, you have no other excuse. You've seen the prophets are out there on the street letting y'all know this is what's going on. Period, point blank. That's why you need that little grain of mustard seed. If you don't got it, if you don't, you know, if you hear these words and be like, maybe, you better fall down on your knees and pray to Yahweh Hashem Yahshai to open up your eyes so you can see it and understand and repent and be healed. Okay? Because nothing else matters right now. That marching and shit ain't going to help nothing. All right? I'm looking at the time so I don't mess up again like I did last week. Okay. Wherefore, hear the word of the Lord, ye scornful men that rule this people which is in Jerusalem. Because Jerusalem are a people before it's a place. Okay, so you're talking about the children of Israel, the 12 lost tribes. Because you have said, we have made a covenant with death, and with hell are we in agreement. When the overflowing scourge shall pass through, it shall not come unto us. For we have made lies our refuge, and under falsehoods have we hid ourselves. So these are the elites, the Illuminati. It's like we were talking about the old son of Lucifer. Okay, and the Edomites, all of the whole nation, okay, gonna get judged for this. Because you rule the people, you rule over Jerusalem. You put them down in these ghettos. You put them down in this hell, okay, the condition of the mind. Because you said, we have made a covenant with death, because you don't mind killing, because the blessing is the sword. And with hell are we at agreement. So you agree to keep these people down when you can uplift people with the scriptures. You can follow the ways that the Lord has put forth to force live, but you don't want to do that. You want to be the devil. You want to be the bad guy. You want to be greedy and corrupt. Huh? And wicked. And with hell are we at agreement. Wherein the overflow scourge shall pass through, it shall not come unto us. For we have made lies our refuge, and under falsehood have we hid ourselves. Therefore, thus said the Lord God, behold, I lay in Zion for a foundation a stone, and a tried stone, a precious cornerstone, a sure foundation. He that believe shall not make haste. So that's talking to us. Because the Lord put this cornerstone, which is the Messiah, Yahweh Shai, the words. He said, I am the word, the scriptures. So we're going to believe these words, and we're going to wait on the Lord to come back. Because it goes on to say, judgment also will I lay to the line, and righteousness to the plummeth. And the hell shall sweep away the refuge of lies, and the water shall overflow the hidden places. So everything is going to be revealed right now. And your covenant with death shall be disannulled, and your agreement with hell shall not stand. When the overflow scourge shall pass through, then ye shall be trodden down by it. So the Lord is saying, your time is up. Your time is up. Now let's go ahead and we're going to wrap it up with, we got two more scriptures to wrap it up, man. I'm going to have to reset this thing, and I'm just going to do it now. This epistle might be a little long, but hey, all praises to you. How about Shema Al Shai? Because it had to come out, man. Yeah. it had to come out. And I appreciate the Lord for not taking out the Holy Spirit from me and giving me the understanding to be able to bring this out, okay? So this is the book of Revelation chapter 21, verse 1. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of Yahweh Shem El Shai is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all the tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I will make all things new. And he said unto them, said unto me, Write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said unto me, It is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is at thirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things. I will be his God, and he shall be my son. But the fearful and the unbelieving and the abominable and the murderers and the whoremongers and the sorcerers and the idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. So there we go again. He's talking about the lake of fire, because everybody that has not repented to the one true living God is not covered with the blood of the Lamb. That's your judgment, man. That you are fearful, you're unbelieving, you're abominable, you're murderers, you're whoremongers, you're sorcerers and idolaters and liars, because you're going along with this wicked kingdom and all the shit that they promote, because they are the devil. They're Antichrist. Okay? And the new heaven and the new earth are the people. The New Jerusalem. We are the people. The Lord is going to bring us, and he's going to change us, change our bodies into something that he's going to put the covenant inside our inward parts. The law, statutes, commandments in our inner. It's going to be beautiful, man. It's going to be beautiful. Now this is the so once again, we're going to close it out with Isaiah chapter 14. Okay, because we're just going to read it. We're just going to read a little bit from the top. I know we read some of it earlier, but For the Lord will have mercy on Jacob and will yet choose Israel. Okay, so this is future prophecy. Because he's having mercy on us now by giving us these law, statutes, commandments again and opening up our eyes, bringing us out of the grave, just like we read in Ezekiel. Blowing that breath into us so we know who we are, so it gives us time to repent and come back. The remnant shall come back to the Lord. Okay, it's already written that two-thirds of our people will be cut off. And those are, the Negro, Hispanics, and Native American Indians. For the Lord will have mercy on Jacob and will yet choose Israel and set them in their land, their own land, and the stranger shall be joined with them, and they shall cleave to the house of Jacob. The strangers are all the other nations. And the people shall take them and bring them into their places. We are the people, and we're going to take them. And the house of Israel shall possess them in the land of the Lord for servants and handmaids. And they shall make them captives whose captives they were, and they shall rule over them. They shall rule over their oppressors. So now, right now, we're in hell. We're being ruled over by our oppressors, which is Esau, Edom, and other nations too. Wherever the so-called the 12 tribes of Israel do reside, in all the other nations, scattered among all nations. They may look like the other nations, but yet they are still under subjection under these nations, because they already know, they in their heart, they know, hey, these people are not really us. You know, there's something about their spirit. So they, wherever you go, there's a certain ghetto somewhere. And who's there? The children of Israel are there. As simple as that, man. But the Lord said, in the kingdom of heaven, when all this thing is said and done, we're going to be in heaven. We're going to be in a state of mind of blissfulness. Remember we read the definition, blissfulness, happiness. While everybody else is going to be under subjection under us, okay? Especially Esau, Edom, the Caucasian race. That's it. And it shall come to pass in that day, this is Isaiah chapter 14, verse 3. And it shall come to pass in that day that the Lord shall give thee rest from thy sorrow and from thy fear and from the hard bondage wherein thou was made to serve. And that's what we do now. We're serving in this hellhole. That thou shalt take up this parable against the king of Babylon, saying, how have the oppressor ceased, the golden city ceased? Okay, and that's what we're talking about when we looked at Saks Fifth Avenue. You know what I'm saying? All those great places, the fatness of the earth. How's the golden city ceased? Babylon the Great, aka America. The Lord has broken the staff of the wicked and the scepter of the rulers. And that's what we read earlier. So with that, I hope this was edifying, brothers and sisters. And I hope y'all had as much fun as I did. And once again, I want to give all honors and praises to Yahweh, Bahashem, Yahweh Shai, Bahashem, and Kakadash. I want to give double honors to the elders and apostles of Great Millstone for bringing out the 100% truth, keeping it real, keeping us in line, keeping us those camps in line, or, you know, always coming down, rebuking, exhorting, giving out the knowledge freely, just doing what it takes, man. Thank you, Tawada. And of course, salutations to the 144 hopeful elect of Israel, who's pushing his word in all truth and sincerity, and the 1/3 of Israel, who believe in the word and follow the Lamb wherever he goeth. Shalom, Israel.